Allison Chains hails from Seattle, Washington, a city that's been in the rock and roll spotlight as of late. But who is Alice, and why is she in chains?
The name originates from five drunk guys forming a thrash band in which they would all dress in drag. And that band never got formed. And I was one of those people.
I'm a little lonely, Mike. So why don't you scoot over?
Do your girlfriends worry about the fact that two people can fit in these bunks?
Two men, yes.
Yeah. Yeah. They worry about that.
I'm here to exercise evil spirits out of me, channel or whatever they do, you know. Something to do with the sap in the trees. Mass death.
Megabur.
Mass death.
Mass holocaust.
You know, we're waiting to get back so we get some of that old down-home cooking, you know?
We're Latvian.
I want to see my long-lost uncle, Georgi.
What we wrote about on Dirt, or what I wrote about, if those were still significant issues in my life today, I might be writing that record all over again, but, you know, as with anyone's life, or you know, with time, you just move on to other things. And you know, there other things were going on during the writing of this record. And I think just the friction and the energy and the outside pecking at us to get going and get moving on this record gave us the inspiration to kind of lash out and in a proper way. We kept this record really, really close to home, really close to the time and the experiences and what we were feeling, you know. We made the record in 4 months, and I think all those songs were just kind of a whirlwind of emotions that happened during the making of that record.
He had saved my life in South America one time. We were touring with Nirvana and the Chili Peppers, and we were playing a big show, a big festival down in South America. And Kurt had taken me into the room, the bathroom, him and Courtney, and we shot up all night. And then Lane didn't know that, and I went to Lane's room, and we shot up, and I OD'd. And so Lane didn't know that, and so he I wake up, and I'm all wet, and I'm laying on over the toilet, and I'm in a different room, and I'm all wet, and he had added me in the shower and everything, and I didn't, you know, I was obviously blacked out during that whole time. Yeah. I was flatlined, and he said, and he's crying, punched me in the face, and I'm like, okay. What's wrong? What did I do? He's like, you were dead for 11 minutes, Mike.
I don't remember.
He's like, what's your shot coke with Alice in Chains all night? I don't remember.
When you have a problem with heroin, does it automatically make you think about death because you're playing with your life a lot, or...
Yeah, I suppose that comes with the territory, flirting with death, and yeah, that's probably what's most attractive about it at first, is the danger, you know. But I beat it, I beat death. I'm immortal.
Is there anyone out there who still isn't clear about what doing drugs does? This is your brain. This is drugs. This is your brain on drugs.
Heroin? I don't know what all this fuss is about. I could handle it. There's no way I'm going to become an addict. I just do heroin.
It's no problem. Look,
I've got this thing under control. I've just got a touch of fluid, babe.
Everyone thinks they can control heroin until it starts to control them.
This is Lane from Alice in Chains, and you're watching Rage, and I get to be the program director tonight, so you're all in for a whole lot of hell, aren't you? So stick around and watch it, or don't. If you don't, you're a shitbag, so keep watching, all right?
His drug addiction had become all-consuming, and in the run-up to the band's planned summer tour, Staley made an appearance at the KISW Rockstock concert at Kitsap County Fairgrounds in late May of 1994, in which he appeared on stage with Tool to perform the song Opiate. According to the Seattle Post-Intelligencer, Lane looked sickly and wore ski masks to hide his face. According to Rolling Stone magazine, at the band's first rehearsal for the Metallica tour, Lane returned from a stint to rehab and showed up to practice high. It was at that practice that Kinney and Cantrell vowed never to play with Lane again. The band's manager, Susan Silver, would release a statement that the band was withdrawing from the Metallica tour and their Woodstock appearance due to health issues with the band.
It's a Jason song, so he's going to have to sing it. Is that okay?
Came together when I was in Minneapolis with our bass player Baker. I was in a rehab and just called up Lane. Baker's been a huge fan of Lane's, and I've known Lane for about 10 years. Called up Barrett and we got together and rehearsed, and things just started happening.
I was in bed and he came in and woke me up and said, "You want to play a show in 3 days with these guys?" And I said, "Yeah, sure. You know, when are we going to practice?" And he said, "Well, we'll practice the night before."
The song is called "Long Gone Day." Mr. Mark Lanegan.
That kind of experience was the most nerve-wracking, scariest experience in my life. We went down and we came up with two or three songs, which the next day nobody remembered a riff or a lyric or anything. They all stared at me and waited for something to come flying out of my mouth, and in front of all those people, it was, you know, I wasn't sure if I was going to run as fast as I could off the stage and out the door, or if I was going to stand there and try and do it. And I stayed there and I spit something out that fit with the music. And I was more satisfied with the Mad Season record than any other recordings I'd done. You know, I wasn't burned out on any of the songs, so that's the way we kind of chose to do the Alice record.
What are some of the songs, new songs on the new record?
Grind, Brush Away, and Heaven Beside You.
First job, dishwasher.
Dishwasher.
No, actually, first job.
Oh, paper route.
Yeah, I had the same thing. Paper route. I don't know if that counts as a job though, because you could be like, as long as you can ride a bicycle, they'll give you that.
I don't think I'd call the guy who slams a paper against my door every night a job. I'm gonna give him a job. Every night I jump off the couch. Wham!
Best part about being a paperboy was dumping inserts. That was
best part about being a paperboy was getting attacked by 7 collies while the owner went, "Grr!" Everyone I was getting interviewed by and the other guys that were searching for a schnazzy way to write an insult, you know, and disguise it. And I was just tired of it. Nobody wanted to know about the music. They wanted to know, are you getting fucked up? You know, are you gay? Are you dying of AIDS? That's, you know, I'm usually the last to hear that I'm dying of AIDS or whatever it is.
remember being surrounded by friends like you guys. You guys were all f***ing there. And we had a lot of other friends there too. And you're right, that and the Kiss shows, I think that was it. Knowing that my band's probably f***ing over, and, you know, knowing that one of my friends might be committed to going out that way, that's a tough thing to live with and still try to keep that internal and support the group. And also, none of us really wanted to control one another. We just wanted to f***ing exist. And if that's where somebody's going to go, then that's what they're going to do. And we all went through that to some degree. And I don't think I was in great shape either. I think I was not feeling too hot either by my own hand. I think that that's why all of that is in there, because right. All of that background that I just described, we were all living in that and knowing that we're coming to the end of it here. Unless something really drastically changes, we're coming to the end really quick. And I think part of that is in that performance.
Harold, can I tell you a story about when I saw them once?
Yeah.
I saw them at MTV when they were taping that Unplugged.
Yeah.
And I guess the singer was so screwed up that he was sliding off the stool that he was sitting on while he was performing. What? Guy would have to come over and like lift him up and like reprop him up on the chair.
Right.
Wow. And then he must have screwed up the same song about 50 times. They'd have to stop in the middle and they'd have to start over because they were taping the show.
Afterwards, they led me to believe that we'd all become great friends. You know, we had a great time doing the video, and they said, yeah, we'll be great friends, we'll hang out. So I called him when I went to Seattle. I never heard back from him. I called him, never heard back from him. But I know tonight, after the show, that we're all going to be really great friends and hang out. Right, guys?
We'll exchange numbers later if we
But can we find. Get hang out, though, right? No. Yeah. Anyway, Alice in Chains.
In April of 1997, an entity known as the Laresta Trust bought a three-bedroom, 1,500-square-foot, fifth-floor condominium at a building in Seattle's University District for $262,000. Laresta is named for John Laresta, the alias Lane was using at the time. His condo would be Lane's home for the final 5 years of his life. Hey, Lane wants to see you, Shush told Biro at the party. Great, where is he? He's right behind you. Biro turned around. I'm looking past this really skinny, fucked up looking guy, trying to see where Lane is, and it was Lane. I felt really awkward. He had a baseball cap on. He had glasses down to the end of his nose, and not very many teeth. It shocked me at first. It looked like death. It was gross. Lane invited Biro to check out his condo, which was around the corner from the bar. He described Lane as being very proud about his home. Lane had a massive rear projection TV, and all he did was sit there and get high and play video games all day. Biro, who was clean, asked, "Wow, have you got anything?" referring to drugs. "Yeah, but I'm not going to give it to you." "Why not?" "Because you're clean. I'm not going to be part of this. If you need to go do that, you do it somewhere else. I don't want to be part of it. I don't want you to end up like me again." That was the last time Biro saw him. In the late summer or early fall of 1998, songwriter, producer Matt Cirlotek and Rage Against the Machine guitarist Tom Morello were putting together a supergroup called the Class of 99 to record a cover of Pink Floyd's Another Brick in the Wall for director Robert Rodriguez's forthcoming sci-fi horror flick, The Faculty. They still didn't have a singer. A few names floated, including Zach De La Rocha of Rage Against the Machine. What about Lane Staley? It was kind of an instant yes if he's up for it. Cirlotek contacted Sony Records to act as a conduit between them and Lane. Cirlotek eventually heard that Lane wanted to do it. I didn't know what to expect, but he looked rough, Sir Letek recalled. At this point, he had lost most of his teeth. He was incredibly shy. It was kind of a shock to see him. I wouldn't have recognized him. He looked different. He didn't look like himself anymore. Sir Letek and his team tried to make it as comfortable as possible for him, and he finally came down to sing at 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning. Lane's lisp was apparent, so Sir Letek had to redo some of the material where the letter S was especially pronounced.
We don't need no education. We don't need no thought control. The sarcasm in the classroom. All in all, it's just another brick in the wall.
And Chains with Sean and Mike and Jerry, and I guess Lane Staley's about the only one we're missing here right now.
Put him on the phone.
Lane, are you on the phone?
Yeah, I'm here.
Hey, welcome to Rockline, man.
How you doing?
Staley.
Blanche Staley.
Hey.
And Barry, what was the question about the box set?
Is it going to be the last project you guys will put out as a band together?
Hey, we don't put out. I would hope not.
Yeah, we don't put out.
We don't put out, pal. You know what I'm saying? We're high dollar hoes.
Yeah.
I think we'll do something else, probably.
There you go, from Lane State.
All right, there you go.
Rockline.
Okay, we will.
All four members of Alice in Chains with us tonight, and we're going to play this demo of Sea of Sorrow. Jerry, you seem to know a bit. Return. Hi, Denise.
Hello.
Hi.
Welcome to the show.
How you doing?
I'm great. All of your songs are completely perfect, but what I want to know is, out of all of your CDs and songs, which ones do each of you consider your most successful work?
No, baby. What do you consider my most successful work?
Either way, Forrest and Frusciante went to Lane's apartment to meet with him in Seattle, and according to Forrest, his mind worked, but he was a million miles away. He was playing a video game the entire time they were talking. Hey, Lane, what's going on? Forrest would ask. Nothing. I know why you're here, Lane would respond. Your mom's worried, man. You don't look too good. Lane's appearance, according to Forrest, was that his skin looked like bleach Valium, and his weight dropped below 90 pounds. Now, he entered the end stage of the game, Forrest would recall. I'm okay though, really, Lane insisted. Eventually, Frusciante and Forrest would leave. Forrest would tell Frusciante, I don't think he's going to come out of this. It's his life, man, Frusciante would reply.
Thank you.
Mike would end up going to Lane's condo, and the two would end up watching television on April 4th. Mike would later say, quote, "I was flipping through the channels and stumbled on the John Edwards show Crossing Over, a show that claims to communicate with his audience's late loved ones." While watching Crossing Over, Lane turned to Mike and said, quote, "Demery was here last night. I don't give a fuck if you fucking believe me or not, dude. I'm telling you, Demery was here last night." The two would inevitably end up getting in an argument over Mike Starr's use of benzodiazepines and pills, with Lane Staley claiming that, quote, "You're fucking stupid on these pills, man. You gotta get off this shit." Of course, because of Lane's use of drugs himself, Mike would respond argumentatively regarding Lane Staley's own use of heroin or cocaine, and told him that he would call 911 because of his condition. Lane would then threaten Mike to never talk to him again if he had called 911. The two would continue arguing, and Mike would head for the door, storming out, with Lane Staley stating, quote, "No, please don't leave like this, man. Not like this. It can't end like this."
I was with Lane the day, it was my birthday. He died the day after my birthday. And I was with him all that day on my birthday, trying to keep him alive. And I even asked him if I could call 911, you know, and he said if I did, he would never talk to me again. And of course, I didn't know he was going to die, or I would have called 911 anyways.
Frontman Lane Staley was found dead in his Seattle home on Friday. He was 34. Seattle police say they responded to a call from one of Staley's relatives asking them to check on his well-being since he hadn't been seen in 2 weeks. Police then discovered a body, later identified as Staley, that had been deceased for at least a few days, surrounded by intravenous drug paraphernalia. Exact time and cause of death are still being determined. Alice in Chains haven't been an active band in some years, yet they did surface for a session of MTV's Unplugged in 1996 in what would have been one of their final live performances.
The lead singer of the rock band Alice in Chains has been found dead in his Seattle home. The partially decomposed body of 34-year-old Lane Staley was discovered Friday night. Medical examiners identified it during an autopsy Saturday. Authorities have not yet released the cause of death. Seattle police say there were no signs of foul play and there was nothing suspicious. Alice in Chains was one of the most successful bands of the grunge rock era in the early 1990s.
All right, welcome to a special edition of Loud. This is actually not special at all, nor is it fun. We're going to take the next hour on this program and remember the life and the music of Lane Staley.
Music fans, especially those here in Seattle, are mourning the loss of Lane Staley, lead singer for Alice in Chains. Staley was found dead last night in his Seattle area apartment.
Well, this guy's dead. The lead singer of Alice in Chains is gone. But everyone knew it was a matter of time. These guys could have made a lot of money, but the lead singer was so effed up.
He was another one of those guys.
Yeah.
Couldn't make the cut.
Nah, they beat the odds. They had a hit band. And every time they'd even try and go out on tour, the lead singer was always whacked out on heroin, I guess. Yeah. Someone said they saw him and he had like track marks between his fingers.
Oh.
You know what I mean?
mean? Like every time you
so
saw him,
yeah.
It was just, it was not even hidden.
When your child passes, you lose your baby. You lose your form. And I get very emotional trying not to do that here. He was very honest with me about drug addiction. He was in and out of treatment 10 times. He was in the emergency room. He probably died 5 times and was revived by friends. And we talked about it.
It's terrifying.
It's terrifying because you can't help. He knew he had the money. He could take the time. He had sponsors. He knew where to go. And the band said, Lane, do whatever you need to do. But he was stalked by addiction. And it's a brain disease. And it is in our family in different forms.